Hi, it's Bob Kraft of TennisMinistry.org, and today we're leading up to the French Open in the year 2011. I have great memories of the French Open. Paris is a beautiful city. The weather is fabulous. It's quiet. It's peaceful on the streets. And there's a special atmosphere at the tournament. When you go into the players' lounge, there's a lot of older European players who come there who don't normally go to tournaments. So you see people like Ilie Nastasi, Tyriac, Wojciech Fibak, many of these older players who've been around a long time, and they use that as the meeting time to come together with their old friends. So it's a very important time. Now, this tournament, I'm going to talk a little bit about a player that is very dear to my heart. It's a bit tough to talk about, and it may be a little bit longer than a normal time. I may even break it up into two parts, because there's a lot to this story, and this involves Mary Pierce. Now, for those of you who don't know Mary Pierce, she has won a few Grand Slam tournaments, including the French Open, the Australian Open. She's been in several finals of singles. She's retired as of about 2 or 3 years ago. She had an injury in Zurich that was career-ending, and from that moment on, now she's never officially retired, but I don't think her game is going to go back to where she can really play on the pro tour at the highest level. And I would like to tell you, share a little bit about Mary Pierce and my relationship. It really changed my ministry. My relationship with Mary changed who I am and what I do, and it changed what people thought of me on the pro tour, so it's a very important thing. And on top of that, she became a very committed Christian, and I'm happy about that. Now, Mary was somebody that was in the press many years ago, even back in the year, say, 2000. She was very high profile, often in the media, and there would be quite a lot written about her faith because she was a Catholic, and it would show her with prayer beads. But at the same time, there were things that were going on in her life that weren't very healthy, and they weren't a good witness for a Christian. She had a relationship with a boyfriend that was, they weren't married, but they were living together. This was all public knowledge, and that kind of went by the wayside. There was some tough situation with her father where it was an abusive relationship physically and mentally, and that was all in the press, and the father got banned from the tournaments through the WTA, and this was a journey for Mary. Now, Mary, again, she had her highest ranking was number 3 in the world back in the year of the 2000s, the early 2000s, and she had been in she'd won a Grand Slam final two actually. So her coaching situation during this time would vary from coach to coach. She had a few coaches. It was her father, but they couldn't really get along well, and so that stopped. And then there were some other coaches, and that took a lot of credit for Mary's success. Mary is a very gifted athlete, very athletic, and hits the ball as hard as any player on the pro tour. So that sometimes the success they take credit for. Even last week I read a coach who worked with her briefly while I actually was working with her, and I knew the circumstance, and he took a lot of credit for her doing well in the last couple years. I don't think that was accurate. And then there was her brother. Now, her brother and she had a very close relationship. His name is David. He came in right about the time, just before I started to work with Mary as a pastor and as an advisor. He came in with her and started working with her. And of course, that's a family relationship, and they were very close, and he's a very good coach for his sister. He knows what to say and what to do. He's a reasonably good player. And that was the first thing that happened, was that the brother was around more. Some of the coaches, one in particular who was just before her brother David, was very controlling. And I would try to share, because I knew Mary had an interest in spiritual things based upon these media interviews that had happened in the years past. And the coach would basically work against me. He would try to stop me. And, you know, I always sensed that it had to do, and he wouldn't even get messages to her and so forth. And He was controlling her. It wasn't really about helping her. So I've seen that now with a number of players that he's worked with, including top players. And the thing that always comes out is that they never have him around. After they drop him, they don't ever invite him back into their circle. So, you know, there's a problem there, we could say. But Mary moved into with her brother's relationship as far as the helping and the coaching, the traveling bit. And I was at the Australian Open. I can't tell you the exact year. I wish I could know the details. But just say it was 2004 or 2005. And she was playing a match on the outside court, and she had a tough point, and she threw her racket all the way across the court, you know? And at that point, as a pastor, and especially I felt God was really speaking to my heart about trying to help her, I approached her after the match, and she was a basket case, really, you know? She wasn't following the Lord. She was very frustrated and coming out of this coaching relationship, which was a very controlling thing. And from that moment on, I remember she asked me, she started talking to me, and she was very happy to meet me. I started working with her on a continuous basis from that moment onwards. And she was ranked around 48th in the world, so her ranking had dropped from a top 10 player down to 48. She was very frustrated, and she wasn't playing well. And there was another person who, she came up to me and she said, "What do you think of this coach? He's from France." And at that time, I really didn't know him very well. I just said, "Well, he seems to be okay. You know, he's a Christian and a supposed Christian." And I said, "Okay, you know." Well, as it turned out, a few years later, I found out a lot more. But okay, that he came into the picture a little bit based upon my recommendation. And all of a sudden, we had a strong team. We had her brother. We had myself, who was a spiritual person and also giving her advice. We had her mother was around. Before, her mother wasn't really around much. All of a sudden, her mother was at the tournaments, especially the main tournaments. We had this coach who was kind of a scout against other players and a positive, saying positive things. And that was the team. So we started working together as a team. And of course, I had other players I was working with. I just wasn't working with Mary Pierce. But, you know, players knew that I was spending time with her. And she was a very famous player, so everybody knew who she was. And she was well-liked among the other players. So they would see me sitting with her for, you know, hours and hours. They'd see me talking to her. And, you know, they started to pay attention. And we're talking about the very top players, people like Justine Henin, Maria Sharapova, and Emily Marasmo. They hadn't really paid attention to me before that time because I was working with players that were 20, 30, 40, down up to 100. And, you know, the top players just didn't need to pay attention. But all of a sudden, they started paying attention. That was a defining moment in my ministry because all of a sudden, people like Justine Henin were sitting next to me and talking to me. And that's what happened. It grew from there. Now, Mary started to go up and up. Her ranking started to go higher and higher. She started playing well. And going into the different tournaments at the French Open, now it was a very unusual time because I was spending time with her. I'd be doing Bible studies with her in the evening times. I'd be teaching her the Bible. I'd be praying with her. We'd be talking about spiritual things, basically. And the interesting thing was that she said to me, all of a sudden, now she wasn't really expected to make it to a finals of a Grand Slam. She was a little bit past her peak as far as her age goes. She hadn't done well for a number of years in tournaments. And all of a sudden she was making it round after round after round. She was beating players that she shouldn't beat. People started to write about this. Now at the French Open, of course, she's partially French. Her mother is French. So she was media news, the main media news actually. And so she said to me, she said, "Bob, I want you to come into before I go on the court to play my matches, I want you to come with me and I want you to pray with me." And David, her brother, was with us. And so we went, she had to get special permission. I went down into the stadium, right next to the stadium where the players go into the stadium court. There's some massage rooms. There's private, quiet rooms where the masseuses use it as a place to massage, or a player can use it as a quiet room. And that was the tournament had to give me permission to go there because it's right next to the stadium door. And the TV, when they open those doors, the TV cameras are right there pointing at the door, which is what happened. So we would go in there and we'd pray. We'd pray for the match. Now, for me, it wasn't about Mary win the match, okay? It was about do your best, have quick feet, good hands, good eyesight, give glory to God. It was that kind of prayer because sometimes there's misconceptions about, you know, is it about all about me winning matches? And Mary never really felt that. Now, her brother, it turned out, did feel that. And the other person, the coach, that was their approach. Oh, we're going to have some special favor. But I never felt that way. So Mary beat Lindsay Davenport, totally unexpected. Lindsay was a much better, higher ranking and had a better record. I was there in the player's box, beat Lindsay Davenport. Beat Amelie Mauresmo, very big upset win. Amelie was at the top of her game at that time. Then she came into the finals. She made it to the finals, and she had to play Justine Henin. Now, all of us were very excited because we understood this was almost like a miracle. You know, she was sharing her faith that she would give press interviews. She would be talking about her faith. But then all of a sudden, she's in the finals, beat all these players, and she's in the press, and we just were shocked. And she felt, you know, she didn't want to admit it, but she felt that God had given her some social favor, and she was going to go and win this tournament and give the glory to God. Well, it didn't work out that way, Mary. We're in the player's box, sitting there with Justine Henin's coach and her friends, and Mary loses to Justine very quickly, all right? Justine just played a great match and played. She had the kind of game that gave Mary trouble, difficulty, and she lost. And Mary was really shocked by that because she felt that God was going to be with her for this match. She was going to do this miracle. And but there were changes that took place. All of a sudden, from that time onward, Mary started to do really, really well in tournaments, including Wimbledon was the next big tournament, which I was there with her for, and I'll talk to you about that maybe in the next video. And there were some special things that happened there, but the relationship started to break down among the people because at least two of them had felt that God was going to give her favor. And I just wanted her to give glory to God, and whatever God did was up to him. And Mary was kind of in the middle, and it was a bit of a tug of war there with that. And there were some people during that French Open that came into the scene that weren't very healthy for her, that were Christians, which is going to be part of the next video. Because like I said, I really feel this is a very, if you love Christ, you love tennis ministry, and you love tennis, this is a very important story, is what's happened. And that year, Mary changed a lot, and she went in a different direction. But that's the story of the French Open, and the next thing I'll do is I'll pick it up where this group had come in, and they started to work with Mary, and how that all transpired, and then I'll lead that into the French Open and then the U.S. Open. And then from that point on, my working with Mary kind of stopped. So, thanks.